Now, what I asked Frank Cottle to do, by the way, Frank Cottle, I just want to mention one thing. The thing about Frank Cottle is that I can never ask him to help me. The reason is that he always beats me to the punch. He, whenever we are in contact, he jumps the gun and says, Ray, how can, what can I do to help? And I really, really appreciate that. So, Frank, I was wondering if you can comment on this premise and the premise that he just brought up, number one, and what are the ramifications if it's true what he's saying? Is it, I haven't been able to figure out if it's good, if people are going to be returning back to the office and working mostly out of the office, or if it's not good for us. I'm talking as business centers. So could you address that? I know you're not a behavioral psychologist, but you play one on TV. So let me see if you can just give us some information on your reaction to that, and you can sort that out for us. I appreciate it.
Certainly. Happy to help out however I can. I'm going to go up to a higher level and look at this a little bit. So I think that the guest on that TV program was candidly just defending something he had written, rather than really thinking from a high perspective about what's going on. And had you heard the other guest who would be refuting his position, the first thing you would have noticed is she needed to reduce her dose of caffeine. She was really, really wound up. So pay attention to what they say, but listen between the lines. So a couple things that have been said here today. Great economy. The economy is going great in spite of this stuff. And it's really the markets that are going great rather than the economy. But look at that in general, and then go down and think, you know, of the conversation going on between the CFO and the CEO of any major Fortune 1000 company right now. They're walking through their offices and they're looking around. CFO says, there's nobody here. And the CFO looks around and says, yeah, but the company's doing great. And they both laugh and they jerk and give each other a high five and say, we don't need this shit. And they don't. So the fact of whether we're going to be going hybrid workplace, whatever label we're going to be putting on this, we have come to the realization that work is going to change. The future of work has changed. It always is. This just happens to be a very big change. And if everybody in New York, if every employer in New York just puts their teams out to one day a week of working from home or working from near home, regardless of what it is, that's an overall 20% vacancy use factor. 2 days a week is 40%. So that's what's going to go on in the world in the future. IDC in 2019 said that by 2020, this is before pandemics, we'd have 1.8 billion remote workers worldwide, and they define those workers as people that work out of the office two or more days a week on a permanent basis. Well, I would say that we could double down on that number right now overall, and it's not going to change. Whenever someone does something seven times for 7 days, 7 weeks, 7 months, whatever someone has a repetitive new motion they go into, they create a new habit. So my new habit is working from home and talking to my dog. My dog really likes it, so I'm not going to change. I'm going to continue to work from my home a minimum of 2 and probably 3 days a week for the rest of my life. And I know a lot of people are going to go through that. And it's not that we are becoming isolationist or agoraphobic. It's not that we're really becoming less productive. We had a major company-wide survey that was done by an outside group, and our own team, of which there's about 80 people, our own team determined that in the aggregate that they felt they had been 83% more productive during this pandemic period than beforehand. And I'll tell you why. It's because they all learned, and I think this is true of everybody right now, they all learned how to make decisions on their own. They didn't have to walk down the hall, ask permission to do something. They just figured out how to do it. I'll go to Martin's numbers. Martin's numbers are up overall. Ours are, God, we're just crushing it. We're just happy campers right now from a business point of view. And I think that really that comes down to people are going to go for more flexibility. They enjoy that. They're going to learn to make more decisions on their own. Technology, I refute the guest speaker who said that communication deteriorated if you're more than 30 meters away or whatever he said. Technology is allowing us to communicate very effectively on a different level. And once you've established an initial relationship, a lot of people know me and they say, oh, Frank has something he's going to share here. You don't have to see me in person to understand what I'm saying or to get as much benefit about what I'm saying as if we were in person. Like a lot of people prefer to have me 3,000 miles away. So I don't think some of these things we're going to worry about or that others are worried about. I think they're overanalyzing. People are just going to make their own decisions and move forward. The good news for our industry, and I really think it is good news in general, is that every major company is going to have a flexible workplace plan in place, or two things will happen. First, they won't be competitive in the labor market, so they will lose the war for talent, which means they will stop their corporate growth, and that's bad overall. And they're going to learn to use technology and communications very differently in every aspect of their operation. So if every major company in the world, just take the global Fortune 1000 or the S&P or any index you want, and let's just assume that they all have everybody work one day a week from outside of the office, and that half of those people choose to work near home instead of from home. Because a lot of people don't have a suitable workplace at home. Just make that number, go through the numbers, create any numbers you want, and you would find that if you took 100% of our industry today, you could double or triple the industry size and still not have capacity to service those people. And every major company will do that because they want not just to have a flexible workplace program to win the talent for war, but they also want to win the talent for capital. And the reason that CFO and that CEO were so excited and happy about this change is because of debt on their balance sheet. Okay. On average, the global Fortune 1000 company has 8 years of leasehold debt on every office on average that they hold. That leasehold debt sits on their balance sheet. If they can remove 25% of that debt on their balance sheet, that's additional capital that they can borrow for business growth to drive their stock value. Every analyst in Wall Street understands this right now. And therefore, the analysts will drive the CFOs to inform the CEOs, we have to stay with a flexible workplace or our stock value will not be competitive in the future. End of game. It's done.
Thanks for that information, Frank. I really appreciate that perspective. I did cut off because we wanted to keep our 8-hour conference day to 2 hours, so I did cut off. But if Ed and of you are asking me if I can send you the link to the entirety of it, it's only 12 minutes long. I will send that out to you. What I did want to do, though, Frank, before we sign off, is I did want to ask you. I know you recognize almost everybody on this call because a lot of us are all alliancers or whatever you want to call it. Can you just give us a quick rundown on Alliance and on All Work, which is my Bible, and just give people a good sense of what you're up to in those areas, and then we'll wrap it up that way.
Alliance is doing its thing and doing well. We had a very good growth in 2020 and even better growth so far in 2021. So we're just happy in that regard, all aspects of it. With All Work, it's like I'm doing a jumping up and down happy dance right now. Our social media reach on behalf of the industry last month in all work was 33 million people. We had over 500,000 articles read last month. So, well, again, when we look at the size of the industry, 500,000 articles, let's say there's 25,000 centers, that means that for every center in the world, 20 people read an article on Allwork last month. So our industry and its participation in the future of work is critical, and everybody's starting to recognize it. And I think that's one of the first comments I think Andrea made and others made, is I used to just have to explain to people what we did. People get it now, and we're becoming mainstream, and we just have to keep up the pace and outlive this silly pandemic.
Okay, well, thanks so much for your input. Again, anybody interested in more information on Alliance Business Center Network, ABCN, and All Work, if you're not getting All Work, if you're not reading All Work, you're a step behind everybody in the industry, I promise that. But reach out to Frank or reach out to me, and I'll make you the connection. So thanks again, Frank. I appreciate that. And I am delivering this pretty close to two hours in about 4 minutes or whatever. I did want to let you know that we want to continue this dialogue. I have a few people that I'm going to be asking if they can join us for the next Zoomcast that I'm going to do. Certainly, we're due for another dose of Jennifer Brooke, if she can join us. And also, Lori Spies, I hope that you can join us on a panel or at least speak at our next webinar. And I think that I also wanted to congratulate that now, Lori, this is your 40th year over at OffiCenter up in Minneapolis. And Ed Munger, you might be like 50 years. I don't even know. I remember you started as a stock boy or something like that at the Worldwide Business Center. But we have some people who've been around for a long time in our industry and a lot of knowledge. And we want to thank them for participating. We want to thank all of you for taking time out from your busy schedules and participating today. I hope you got some value out of all the various things we spoke about. I want to thank Yardi for being our sponsor, our diamond sponsor again, for Kazem at the New York City Summer Conference Center, my right-hand person, literally at my right hand right here. He's always so wonderful and helpful for that. And I thank all of you, and I hope you all have a happy Father's Day. And until we meet again, okay, let's keep on keeping on. We're back.